Sunrise, a sudden court hearing in the George Floyd death case. What attorneys for the prosecution and defense are now asking.
Tough question after tough question.
Have you seen the George Floyd video?
Judge, you're not willing to make a deal.
It's distressing not to get a straight answer.
Supreme Court nominee Amy Coney Barrett back on the hot seat. The newspaper ad that could come back to haunt her.
A cloudy and cool start to the morning. Pack the umbrella. Wind speeds increasing by the afternoon.
Flu season is coming in fast. But with the pandemic, how do you spot the difference between symptoms? The three things you should know before getting tested.
And First Avenue running out of time.
Live music venues, theaters, clubs, they were the first to close. We will be the last to reopen.
What the iconic music venue is doing to save its stages. It's Wednesday, October 14th. Care 11 Sunrise starts now.
Thanks for waking up with us. Parts of the metro, as you can see right here, waking up to rain. Yeah, the windshield wipers going off there. You can see water on the road. So some wet roads right now, and you got to be careful if you head out there.
Yeah, sure do. You know, we're not used to that wet. Oh, yeah, we are. That's right. Hey, let's get over to Guy. He's going to tell us how much we're in store for today.
Yeah, take it slow out there on the roads. You can see the showers on radar. Also, keep in mind, you know, getting in from outside, you know, watch your step too. A little slippery. I almost slipped myself.
Uh-oh.
There you see some showers on radar making their way off to the east. So I think we'll squeeze in some dry time before they pick right back up again. So not out of the woods yet. And you'll see in your hourly planner a few showers this morning, and then skies turning cloudy with temperatures this morning in the upper 40s and low 50s. So it does feel a bit chilly out there. Winds will be gusting up to about 40 miles per hour come the afternoon. High today of 60.
And looking at your roads right now, we're seeing mostly green, but I did spot a crash. Not here at Snelling, so that's just a different view of the roads. Look at me trying to do Alicia's job.
You're doing fine work. Thanks, Kaya. We're following breaking news overnight in Minneapolis. A six-year-old is safe this morning after getting taken during a carjacking. It happened at 9 last night near the 2900 block of Aldrich Avenue South. That's near the Lynn Lake area. The car was found a short time later, a few blocks away. The kid was still in the back seat, unharmed. Police in Minneapolis and St. Paul say they are seeing a spike in carjackings this year.
A somber celebration this morning for George Floyd's family. Today would have been his 47th birthday.
It's a day before the officers involved in his killing head to court with some new evidence on both sides of the case.
That's right. And Jennifer Austin joins us live from home now this morning to break down what that evidence is. Good morning, Jennifer.
Good morning to you. That hearing is scheduled for tomorrow. Attorneys on both sides of this case are pushing for that additional evidence to be included. So on the defense side, Earl Gray, the attorney for former Minneapolis police officer Thomas Lane, wants video of a May 2019 arrest of George Floyd to be allowed as evidence in Lane's motion to dismiss the charges against him. Gray argues Floyd acts similar in the video as he does in the May 2020 incident that left him dead. Gray argues the state's case is a false narrative, and the similarities in the prior case prove that. Meanwhile, the prosecution wants the judge to allow details from 18 past incidents involving the former officers into the trial, arguing these cases are relevant to the George Floyd case because they demonstrate Derek Chauvin's MO, or pattern of behavior. In several of the cases, they accuse him of using the same neck restraint he used on Floyd, calling it the common method Chauvin uses when dealing with people larger than him who may be intoxicated. The judge has also previously said that he expected to rule this week on several important issues related to next year's trial. Chris and Gia.
All right, Jennifer, thank you for that.
Floyd's death sparked protests and unrest throughout the Twin Cities. This morning, we're getting a look at a new report from the Republican-led state Senate slamming Governor Walz and Mayor Jacob Frey for their response following Floyd's death.
Okay, so this report claims Governor Walz and Mayor Frey failed to realize the seriousness of the riots and the dangers to Minnesotans. Well, the report also claims if they had acted faster, with more force, the destruction of the third precinct would have never happened. And if this ever happens again, the report says the governor should activate the National Guard sooner and arrest and prosecute those who commit crimes while protesting. So a spokesperson for Governor Walz responded to this report saying, quote, if Minnesota Republicans want to uphold law and order, they should stop holding up the governor's proposal to ensure public safety.
We're taking you live from the state capitol this morning. Day three of the state's special session starts in just a few hours. On today's agenda is that bonding bill they've been working on for months. It would help pay for construction projects across the state. House Republican leader Kirk Doubt has said he wouldn't vote on it until Governor Walz gives up his emergency powers, something Walz just extended for at least another month. While lawmakers debate inside the Capitol, a group of Minnesota care workers will be outside of the building protesting. They're calling on lawmakers to include home care workers to the supplemental bill. They say they've been working on the front lines without hazard pay or extra paid sick time if they get exposed to the virus.
And Chris, we need to fill you in on what's happening in Wisconsin this morning. So today, the state is opening an overflow hospital for COVID-19 patients outside of Milwaukee at the state fairgrounds. And that's because Wisconsin, as you can see, continues this dangerous explosion of cases. Yesterday, two single-day highs in deaths and new cases. 34 people died. So take a look at the new cases, those blue bars back here. And you can see that yesterday was more than 3,200, the last record of new cases just last week. And that explosion means that the two-week average here, this dotted line, now stands at around 2,500 per day. And Minnesota has recorded a sixth consecutive day of 1,000 plus new cases. So we keep looking at this blue bar going up. And MDH says that 1,100 cases were reported yesterday. That's out of more than 19,000 tests. The governor hoping to increase testing capacity with new sites. The 14-day moving average, as you can see, still going up, and about 1,200 cases per day right now, Chris.
Calm on Capitol Hill this morning, but that will change in about 2 hours when Supreme Court nominee Judge Amy Coney Barrett takes the hot seat for a third day of questioning. Kaya, they're grilling her on everything from civil rights to what she has in her notepad.
Yeah, or what she doesn't have. More on that in a second. But a lot of huge moments yesterday that we're hearing about and that are blowing up online. So I'm breaking it all down for you in this morning's Digital Dive. So yesterday, Barrett fielded questions about gay marriage, the Affordable Care Act, and the upcoming presidential election. She was also questioned about landmark abortion case Roe versus Wade. And in a back and forth with Democrat Dianne Feinstein, Barrett declined to characterize the Roe versus Wade decision as a super precedent. But she said her only agenda is to stick to the rule of law and decide cases as they come. Okay, well, Minnesota Senator Amy Klobuchar was in on this too. She said Judge Barrett would be the polar opposite of Justice Ginsburg, the late justice, of course, whose seat Barrett would be filling if confirmed. Well, during the hearing, Klobuchar tweeted, quote, "We shouldn't be filling a Supreme Court seat. We should be passing a relief package." There's also been a concern from Democrats that Barrett would do what President Trump asked, but Barrett pushed back against that.
Judge, you're not willing to make a deal.
No, Senator Cornyn, I'm not willing to make a deal, not with the committee, not with the president, not with anyone. I'm independent.
Another big moment being talked about online, Barrett's comments about George Floyd. Barrett, who has two adopted children from Haiti, said Floyd's death was very personal for her family. And if you've been following along on social media, you probably recognize this notepad. Senator John Cornyn asked Barrett to hold up the notes on her desk, and Barrett held up a blank notebook showing that, hey, she'd been answering questions without any help. Hearings continue today, and you can find updates on our website all day long, care11.com.
Yeah, I've been able to pop in and see some of the bits and pieces of that hearing, but, you know, kind of what we expected from Republicans and also Democrats for Amy Coney Barrett.
Why are always, like, weird little things, like the fly right. with the debates, the notebook,
the notepad. I don't know. There's always something. Kai, thanks.
Yeah.
Now here's a look at today's other top stories in your morning rush. Leaders in St. Paul's Somali community are asking for your help after a mosque was vandalized three times. It happened back in June and August at the school building of a mosque in the Dayton's Bluff neighborhood. Officials say it caused at least $20,000 in damage. If you know anything, you're asked to call St. Paul police.
Another major COVID-19 trial hits pause. Drug maker Eli Lilly has stopped enrollment in its coronavirus antibody treatment over potential safety concerns. We do not know what those concerns are just yet. President Trump is holding a campaign rally in Des Moines today. This comes after the White House coronavirus experts say the Des Moines area is in a yellow zone for COVID-19 transmission. That means experts recommend gatherings there should be limited to 25 or fewer people. And Karl Anthony Towns is pushing for you to vote. He's joining the movement with other NBA stars and put out a PSA urging us all to take part in the election. The nonpartisan PSA was put out on all different types of platforms and shows you the do's and don'ts of voting. And that's your Wednesday Morning Rush.
Guy, what's our one thing weather?
Yeah, clouds this morning. You'll see your school day forecasts with temperatures be in the 50s, upper 50s by noon, maybe a few peaks of sunshine, with things turning windy for the afternoon hours.
And one thing, traffic, you're going to have those wipers going this morning and wet roads as you head out. So give yourself a couple extra minutes. We do have a crash we've been tracking on 694 in the New Brighton area. So if that is where you're driving today, heads up on that.
Thanks, Kaya. Well, is it the flu, strep, or COVID? Before you scare yourself by looking at symptoms on WebMD, we've got a real MD giving us some answers. Dr. Frank Rame is an infectious disease specialist with Allina Health, and he says there are subtle symptoms and some pretty big ones that can help distinguish what you're dealing with. So with the flu, you're going to feel like you've got hit with a Mack truck, so to speak. Symptoms come at you fast, and there's a lot of mucus, a runny nose, exhaustion, fever, and coughing.
Influenza people just have a lot of cough, and they can have these spells of coughing, which leave them short of breath. But it's really the spell of coughing that makes them short of breath. If an influenza patient has shortness of breath, that's pretty severe. That's pretty unusual and really quite a critical illness. But COVID patients will get short of breath, and sometimes they'll even get low oxygen levels without being short of breath.
Okay, so the most distinctive symptom of COVID-19 is a loss of taste and smell.
COVID can attack those smeller cells up in the top. So you can have loss of taste or distortion of taste and smell without any runny nose. And in fact, COVID tends to have less runny nose than other respiratory tract infections do.
And if you're concerned about strep, well, it's in its own stratosphere. So symptoms include swollen lymph nodes and an extreme sore throat. And there are a couple of key takeaways that Dr. Ram wants to share. First and foremost, get your flu vaccination.
Because when people present with influenza-like illness, it's likely to be influenza. We're going to do a test on them, and we're going to do a COVID test on them, and we're going to use up a COVID test on someone who's got influenza. We really hate to use up those COVID tests unnecessarily.
There are even fewer flu tests this year because so many of those resources were diverted towards COVID testing. And Dr. Ram says we're certainly not out of the woods with that either. Yeah, if you're still not sure what you have, call the triage nurse at your health care provider and they can do an evaluation before you go in for testing. Yeah, Chris, I know I was talking about getting a flu shot. I went to my doctor and I asked for one. They said they were out of stock.
Yeah, yeah. People are getting them early this exactly. year, and a lot more people are getting them because of the whole pandemic.
Yeah, but good to know all of those different symptoms. Well, it reads like a movie script. Terrorists trying to kidnap Michigan's governor. Well, now we're learning another state leader may have been targeted.
Then Facebook is cracking down on its biggest moneymaker. What ads you won't see on your timeline?
And selling out is the point. How First Avenue is trying to make up for lost ticket sales during the pandemic.